What's up, everyone? Welcome back to yet another episode of The Real Breakdown. Today is it. Today we talk about Avengers Endgame. Guys, I am so excited about this. Obviously, we got my buddy here, Edgar. You guys know him fully well. We talked Captain Marvel, we've talked Black Panther, and now we're talking Endgame. Pretty big. It's nice to have you back, man. It's nice
Thank
to see you
it's
back.
Nice to be here.
I know you've been working on some stuff yourself, so I don't know if you wanted to share with some of the people some of your projects you're working on.
Yeah, just real quick, you know, shameless plug. I have written a book titled The Legacy of Marvel.
Yeah.
And I have that published, and right now I'm just kind of working on some further projects with that, some sequels and, you know, prequels, the whole nine yards.
Yeah.
Just want to throw that out there.
Awesome.
We'll have an Amazon link at the, you know, on the description.
I'll definitely put a link in there, guys. Make sure you guys check this out. You might see a name that you might recognize in there.
It's possible.
Yeah, awesome. You might see my name in there, maybe. But yeah, guys, make sure you check it out, man. I'm so proud of the work you've done,
Thank you.
I mean, to take everything and to actually publish your own book. That's amazing, man. So definitely wish you the best with that.
Thank you.
So appreciate make sure you guys check that out. I'll put some links in the description below, guys. But yeah, Avengers...
End commercial.
End commercial, right? Avengers Endgame. Mm-hmm. It's finally here. We can finally talk about it. I waited a little bit on doing the review because I wanted to let everyone experience it. I know not everyone could get tickets for it immediately. So first and foremost... also, guys, I already put up my initial reactions... So we're just going to completely bypass that. Make sure you check that video out. It's already on the channel, so make sure you guys check that out. Let's get right into the fact that this is the end game.
Yeah.
This is the end of the 22 film journey that we've been on with the Marvel Cinematic Universe. In your eyes, how do you think it ended? Are you happy with this ending? Are you happy with the fact that you know, it all came down to this? And by the way, guys, also, this is a spoiler review. So we are going to be talking spoilers. You've been warned. It's clearly labeled in the title card. So, spoilers. You've been warned. Last warning. What do you think, man?
So, Tony Stark dies.
Tony Stark dies, guys. We know this.
So, I thought it was, you know, like, for me, that was probably the best experience I've had in a movie theater.
Wow.
I loved it. Because with this movie, so the trailers really didn't give us much.
Nope.
You know, you could not piece together the storyline from the trailers.
Yep.
And with this movie, I made a decision, like, you know what? You know, with other Marvel movies, I've accidentally, like, read a lot of fan... or not even accidentally, because, you know, I did it to myself.
You did it on purpose.
But, like, you know, I read too many fan theories and stuff that, like, even if it wasn't necessarily stuff that was, like, confirmed, you know, while watching it, I was like, oh, well, you know, I kind of expected that or whatever. This one, I was like... No, like, go in there
going
not
in cold.
Anything. Yeah. And watching it that way was so rewarding. Because, you know, you get all these cool little cameos and surprises from, you know, throughout the whole MCU.
Yes.
That, you know, I really do think it's a great conclusion.
Yeah.
Things that, like, for example, like, Alexander Pierce, I don't who would think that he was going to come back? Like,
no.
You know, nobody.
There was no reports that, like,
yeah.
Robert Redford was on set for that, so.
Like, you know, people were like, oh, Quicksilver will come back or something. Like, no, like, nobody expected that.
Yeah.
And I thought
yeah.
that was really cool. When they remade scenes, but almost like in a parody, like, for example, the elevator scene.
Yeah.
When I realized that was happening again, and, you know, it ends completely different, but, like,
yeah.
when I realized they were remaking it, you know, just that, like, it like, got your blood pumping, like, oh my god, like,
yep.
we're, you know,
yep.
we're back here. So I think, you know, from a perspective of taking 22 movies and,
yep.
and you know, finding a way to squeeze in some nods and love to the stuff from, you know, 11 years ago, it
yeah.
did a great job. It did a great job.
I'm right there with you, man. I think that... One of the first things that I said coming out of this, you know, at the time without trying to spoil was that, you know, I kept telling people this is the end game. And not just to
yeah.
be cute, not just to, you know, play on the name of the movie, but
yeah.
I honestly think that this is the closing film of the mm-hmm. chapter that we've been reading or that we've been watching. This
yeah.
is the end of that story that started with, you know, Thanos being introduced, with
mm-hmm.
the Infinity Stones being introduced, with all that stuff, all the little winks and nods that you said that we've been building up, and really rewarding the fans
mm-hmm.
that have watched all these films, and not just, like, not just the diehard fans, but casual fans too, you know, that have been watching these films and saying, look, here's a scene that you've seen before, but it plays out a little different. And the hardcore fans that say, you know, when Captain America says, Hail Hydra, you know, if you're a hardcore fan, you're like, yo, he does that in the comics. What the heck? They were able to throw this in there, but not in the way that we would have thought, you know? Yeah. So to take all that and put it into a movie that finally was 3 hours long. Like, I've been saying Avengers movies should be 3 hours long because I want to get as much of it as I can. I thought it was absolutely done very well. This is a closing film. It closes the chapter that we've been witnessing. And it is an end. It's a finale. It doesn't tease. It doesn't necessarily tease to, hey, but guess what? This is still coming. Yeah. Even though we know that there's more to come, they allow us to enjoy and to sit with the ending of this of this journey we've been on, because you know it ends with no end credit scene.
Yeah,
you know?
No end credit scenes.
And we'll talk a little bit more about that. But and I think that's more to say this is it. We're not teasing anything else because this is it. This is the end of this journey. And for me, it's like I thought that's bold for Marvel to do. I mean, it's bold for any movie to do, because you always want to see, hey, don't worry, come back for more. But they already know that we've been here through 22 films or 21 films. This is the 22nd film. And you know, they're like, guys, we're ending it here. We want to let you sit with that, and then, you know, eventually we'll go on to other things. So I really enjoyed that aspect of it. So I think they did a great job with that. Let's just go right into some of the stuff we loved, man, because this is such a long movie. And for the most part, I think that most of my things are positive. I think there are a few negatives in there, but what were some things that when someone immediately asks you, you're like, this is what I love about it. Boom, 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 boom.
The balance of humor and depth, like emotional depth.
Okay.
You know, there were scenes where I was cracking up for like minutes after the joke happened.
Yeah.
You know, for like example, when Tony comes back and they're all gathered and, you know, Rocket says something and he's like, I thought you were a Build-A-Bear until just a moment ago. I remember the first time I saw the movie, literally I like, you know, like the scene was still carrying on and I was like, oh, I was still there cracking up.
Yes.
Like the fact that, you know, that scene is an emotionally resonant scene. Like Tony has his meltdown and everything.
Woo,
they get that, you know, line.
They squeeze that in there. Yeah.
Like I thought the humor was really well done. Like Captain America admiring his own ass.
Oh my gosh! Yes.
That had me laughing for a while too.
Yep.
But then also just, you know, you get hit with like there are so many scenes that were, it pulled at like your heartstrings.
It does.
Tony being reunited with his dad and kind of finally
closing
that arc where he's finally like, you know what, you did the best you could. Like, because all these other movies, we see him say like, oh, he was cold towards me. He was whatever.
Yeah.
You know, we get that. We get honestly when everybody came out again.
Oof.
Dude, I'm not afraid to say I was crying.
Yeah.
Like I.
Yeah.
Just, you know, you hear Falcon come over like the intercom.
On your left.
Yeah. You see Black Panther come out, and then, you know, everybody just starts coming out. That payoff was done beautifully.
Let's just get that out of the way.
Yeah.
For me, the biggest thing for me, and I said this to you off camera, is that moment where everyone shows up is my favorite moment in the entire MCU.
Yeah.
For a while, it was the airport scene in Civil War, but just genuinely, just as a fan and as a film lover and as a comic book reader and as a superhero nerd, that moment meant so much to me. Every time I speak about it, I get chills. Every time I rewatch it, I get chills. Yeah. And that excitement always comes to me the three times that I've seen it. I think you're on 5, right?
Tomorrow's going to be fun.
He's going to watch it again tomorrow, 5. I'm probably going to watch it again in a few days for number 4. But every time I watch it, that scene resonates with me. That scene alone is something that I have been wanting to see in the MCU for a long time. And we got a little bit of it in the airport scene. That's why, in Civil War, that's why I really enjoy that scene. But this, to me, was the best thing I've ever seen because it finally gave us the idea of, in order to defeat Thanos, it takes the entire MCU. Yeah. That's why the big three couldn't do it. You had the big three finally at full strength. You have Thor wielding two hammers, and it still is not enough.
Yeah.
You know, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. But to finally see that the entire MCU comes together and to just see them all lined up, you know, I have a poster with all of them lined up, right?
Yeah.
We've seen many iterations in the comics of the entire MCU coming together. You can see it in the Thanos storyline, but to actually see it on film with the characters that we've had for so many, for 11 years, 22 movies, it was just riveting to see and to watch that. And so to me, that is the... I could have seen that scene alone and the rest of the movie could have sucked, and I would have still been okay.
Yeah.
You know, but that scene alone, to me, is the best part of this entire movie. It's the reason that I went through 22 movie marathon, and it's the reason why I've been paying tickets to see these movies multiple times, to see moments like that. And as a nerd, I'll say it, I had a nerdgasm. Like, it was just like, I was like, screaming in the theater. So, to me, that was the best scene for me, so I totally agree with you where that's one of the best highlights of the movie. And to kind of add on to what you were saying is that, to me, that balance of being deep and having deep and emotional scenes and also having the levity of the jokes and also being like, hey, this is still a Marvel movie. This is still a fun movie. I really enjoyed... I might not necessarily agree with how they handled some of the comedic elements at some points. I thought that some jokes really hit, but then I thought some jokes they kind of kept maybe playing a little too much, one of them being Thor.
I'll get into that with you.
I think Thor coming in was funny, but then the fact that it kept being a shtick was kind of like, it bothered me a little bit as I've seen it more times, but especially because I love Thor for how Thor is in the comics and who he is in the first few films. And I like Thor Ragnarok, but I felt like they're slowly straying away from what Thor really is, which is fine. I don't think it's bad. I don't think it's a negative per se. So some of the comedy hit for me, but the serious moments are what really, really, I really enjoyed. One of the best scenes, one of the positives that I say right away to people is that moment, and you touched on it already a little bit, that moment where Tony Stark comes back and he says, rips it off and puts it in Cap's hands and says, you put that on, you go take on Thanos, and you do it on your own because you weren't there when I needed you liar. And the fact that he says, he calls him a liar and says, like, you told us that we would do this together and you told us that we would fail together, but guess what? At the end of the day, you weren't there. We failed both separately. We didn't do this together. And to me, that was like, holy crap, because I feel that we also, you know, we needed to have that moment because Civil War happened, you know. It wasn't just like, hey, I'm mad at you, but by the way, next time I see you, what up, dude? How are you doing, you know? And I think that's one of the things that, you know, Batman versus Superman suffered, where it was like, you had Batman and Superman.
A lot of things that movie suffered.
Well, I know, but, like, it's kind of showing that, like, two opposing forces can't just quickly come back together and it's all over, you know? Like, it took, what, 5 years for them to, like, finally, you know, shake hands and say, you know what? Let's do this.
Yeah.
And so that shows the deep relationship between Iron Man and Captain America, and also showing that, like, it is a relationship, and sometimes relationships are rocky and they're not always going to be great. And so I really enjoyed that moment because I felt it was necessary. I would not have liked if Iron Man just came back, healed up, was like, all right, man, let's get ready to go, and not had a moment of like, no, dude, I needed you. You weren't there. We were the Avengers, and we're not the Avengers anymore.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I felt like that, to me, was one of the best scenes in the entire movie, and I really enjoyed it just because it also gave the movie weight. You know, like, it gave the movie a sense of, like, this is not just a superhero movie that's like, oh, explosions and stuff. Like, there's
emotions. Not a lot of action in this until the very end.
Like, exactly.
It's very character-driven.
Yeah, that's true. So, I mean, I thoroughly enjoyed that moment a lot. I think another thing that they did very well, and I think this is something that the Russo brothers don't get enough credit for, is balancing the amount of characters that are in this film. I know that a lot of them don't get as much screen time as we'd like, but I think that we gave them enough screen time to the point that it doesn't get muddled, because sometimes when you have too many characters in one film, especially a huge film like this, how do the storylines intertwine? Yeah. How does this work out? How do each person's emotions and, like, their activities and what they're doing intertwine? So I gotta give huge credit for how they directed this film as far as all these characters coming together and what they're doing when they're at different points and how certain characters are feeling. Hawkeye dealing with the loss of his family straight off the bat and how he's Ronin now and he's doing all these things and how it affects him later on when they're doing the time travel stuff is his own story, and we understand his own story. But then also seeing Natasha and how she's handling everything and the emotion behind that and how she's dealing it, you know, behind the scenes, you know, in front of everyone, she puts up a front, but then when all the cameras are off, she's breaking down and how she's dealing with it. So I think that they did such a good job with not just showing us, but also giving each character their own story and kind of like how they're each dealing with the snap mm-hmm. of Infinity War. So that's one of the things that for me I thought was done really well, because I thought it could have been bad. It could have gone bad really quick.
Yeah.
You know. So any other things that you know maybe you really enjoyed?
There's a lot.
Yeah.
There's a lot. I mean, you know, like I mentioned, that ending was just the perfect payoff. Like, you know, at first, the first time I was watching, I was like, my God, we're 2 hours in and everybody's still dead. But then when it finally happened, like, it was worth it. It was worth the wait. Yeah. And, you know, how you were saying, you know, realistically, like, all the main characters, like, of the original, I guess Hulk not as much, but, like, of the original Avengers, they all have pretty big arcs throughout this movie. We pretty much see them all come to completion. You know, Thor goes from having, like, at the beginning to, like, needing that revenge on Thanos, where, you know, as soon as they see him, he slices his head off, and he's like, you know, I went for the head.
He felt he needed that.
Yeah, like, he needed to get that revenge. To the next time we see him, you know, he's, like, falling apart, because he got that revenge, but it was empty. It was nothing. And then by the end, he's Thor again, you know.
Yeah.
And I'm excited to see him with the Guardians. I really hope that's what they're going for.
So, let's talk about that, because I really agree with what you say as far as, and it's kind of going back off to what I said, the Russo brothers and, you know, the writers, Stephen Marcus and something McFeely.
Christopher McFeely,
yeah.
We might have gotten those backwards.
Yeah, yeah, but credit to them, because they really gave us character development. Yeah. And even Hulk, I think, has his own, but maybe
I feel it's a little more toned down compared
to the toned down, but, like, we do get a little bit, like, it's off-screen mostly.
His is more like, you gotta go back to Ragnarok and, like,
I agree. But, like, he gives us character developments for the characters that we care about. Maybe not everyone, right? Because it would have been impossible. But I really enjoy that. Now, how that character development ended up might have not been my favorite thing. One thing is, I do love Thor's character arc and that idea of that quick revenge but not being fulfilling, and him, you know, getting lost and, you know, just not knowing what to do anymore and just losing himself. I do like. However, I did personally feel that the way that they played it off, to me, like, it was funny at first to kind of see Thor, you know, the muscular, big muscular guy go into, like, what he was. But then I felt like, after a while, I was like, okay, please don't keep him like this forever, because I don't want this to be Thor from now on.
I feel like he, you know, I agree, they did kind of make him the butt of the, you know, the joke of the Avengers for a large part of it.
Yeah.
I do wish that he had, like, not been fat the whole time. Like, I know that might sound bad, but, like, I don't like that it was mainly, like, just pulled for laughs. Like, you know.
Exactly. Yeah. And I think that we did get some redemption for him, but I felt like I wanted more. Like, he could have really pulled through when they're in Asgard and they're, you know, and he just, like, I can't do it, and then dips out. And I'm just like, okay. And the thing is, too, you mentioned the end with Guardians. I don't know if I want that. You know, I don't know. I personally, you know, I mean, and we can disagree on that, but I really like Thor's story with Asgard, and I really like the mythology behind Thor. And I like, you know, the Guardians for what they are, but for me, that ending where, you know, he's talking to Valkyrie and he says, you take over. I mean, to me, it's kind of like, he's like, hey, you take over Asgard. Obviously, I'm not, I need to go figure my stuff out, and then, like, dips out and is like, all right, I'm a Asgardian now, you know, like, Asgardians of the galaxy, you know? And, like, I don't know. I don't know if I'm ready for the departure of Thor, of the Thor that we know. But I'm sure it's going to be something. I don't know what they're going to do. I'm sure it's going to be something funny and something, you know, probably exciting. And I'll probably get excited for it then. But for now, I felt like it wasn't really the Thor that I was kind of
hoping
for. Yeah. And that's okay, right? I mean, not everything is exactly how it is in the comics, but I was okay with it because we did get that character development. I just thought maybe I wanted it to end on a different note. But that's not something that ruined the movie for me, you know? I can still watch it and accept it for what it is. I just felt that, like, okay, I kind of really wanted him to get back to where he was and say, you know what? I'm the king of Asgard, and I'm going to take care of my people. Because it felt like he just ditched them. I mean, to me, at least. I don't know. I just felt like it didn't really tie in with the Thor that we kind of knew initially, and I actually think that they're trying to stray away from it, But I think that's just, it's just me personally that thinks like that. Everyone else loves the new Thor that we have. But I did enjoy him. Like, I don't think he was, like, the worst thing in the world. Yeah, I think you said it the best. He kind of became the butt of the joke.
Yeah.
You know, to me, I think that could have been done better. And I actually felt the same way about Hulk. I felt the same way about Hulk.
Yeah, kind of. I don't think it's as bad.
It's not as bad, but I think when we get introduced to him, you know, it's like, oh my gosh, that shock of, like, seeing Hulk like that, I get it. But then when you get the kids come over and he's kind of this bro. Like, Hulk initially, when they show him to us, he's a bro. He's like, yo, what up? Oh, you want a picture? Yeah, for sure. Hey, Hulk out. You know, like, yo. And I'm just like, okay.
That was a bit much. I'll agree with that.
Yeah. For me, at least, that was a little bit. But then later he gets more serious. And I still enjoyed who he was because, you know, the way that they utilized him for the snap of the initial, you know, the initial gauntlet snap, I thought was great because, he's the only one that, you know, could do it. Hulk and Thor, I just didn't really like how they took those characters. Mm. But then everyone else, I thought they did amazing. Like I thought Captain America's journey was great. I thought Thor's, Iron Man's journey was great. Black Widow's journey, Ronan, you know, even Ant-Man. Like, I thought Ant-Man, like, really got to shine in this movie.
Yeah.
And really, he's the reason that all this kind of was able to happen.
The rat is the reason.
You know what? The rat. The damn rat. When I saw that the first time, I was like, is that what it's going to be? It's going to be a rat? But, I'm okay with it. There's just so much and so many characters. But what about that scene where Scott comes back and he's realizing what's going on?
I thought that was really well done.
And you see not the destruction, but like the post-apocalyptic world that he's in. And he asks that kid, like, hey, what happened here? And the kid's like, are you being serious? Like, why joke about this? Like, dude, stop. And, like, leaving. And then I was like, oh, wow. And then seeing Cassie older. That, to me, was actually a heart pull string moment. Mm-hmm. I don't even know how to say it. But that, to me, I got a bit emotional with that. Like, when he hugs her and, you know, because it's always amazing to see, like, a comedian or someone that's very comedic get serious and get emotional. And so that got me a little bit. And so that was just the first of many, you know, the first of many scenes that, you know, they kind of hit us with that emotion, and so I really enjoyed that. Did you have any thoughts on, like, you know, any, some of the more emotional scenes, or, like, how they treated some of the characters?
Yeah, so the scene, because, like I was saying, there's multiple times where, when I initially saw this movie, I was in tears. Just in complete honesty. So, like, Tony seeing his father again.
Oh, yeah.
What was another one? Tony to death. Dude, that was, this was... I've seen tons of movies in my time. This was the first time I could, like, audibly hear multiple people in the theater crying.
Yes.
His death was really well done. You know, he does the sacrifice, but then, you know, in his last kind of few moments there with the people he loves, when, like, for example, seeing Spider-Man break down and tell him, like, we won. Then, you know, Pepper... I liked how they had a contrast with her, where, you know, whereas Spider-Man's showing you, because grief has so many different faces.
Yes.
Spider-Man is showing you kind of, you know, the more what we're used to, like, breaking down, you know, and whereas Pepper, she knows, like, this is my last moment with him, and I need to...
Reassure him.
I need to reassure him. I need to, you know, let him know everything's going to be okay. Yep. And to hear her say, like, you can rest now, like...
Oh.
As soon as she said that, I mean, the whole scene was very hard to watch, but as soon as she said that, it took it to a whole nother level for me.
Yeah.
I think that was, really honestly, like, I think, you know, that was reminiscent of real death in everyday life. You know, when people lose family members, they have to say things like that. Yeah. And so I thought that was done really beautifully.
I agree with you. I mean, and let's talk about that relationship of Peter and Iron Man, because we see early on in the movie, Iron Man, Tony Stark, is like, hey, I got my second chance. Yeah. This is my... I'm good. He has a daughter now. Like, oh, that was beautiful to see the cute little daughter that him and Pepper have, you know, and he's so reluctant to go back. He's like, nope, this is it. I got my second chance. I'm happy, you know, and then he gets that picture of Peter. You know, and the fact that the not the first thing, but the second thing that Tony Stark says coming off of that ship is, I lost the kid.
Yeah.
That, to me, I was like, immediately was like, oh my God. Because coming back to Earth after, you know, who knows how long, and the first thing that you're saying is, I lost the kid.
Yeah.
to me, it says a lot about that relationship. Mm. And so then when he pulls that picture and, you know, it just reminds you. And that's all they have to do in the movie, honestly. Just see the picture and you're like, oh, that relationship they had.
Yeah.
Because you have Homecoming, you have Civil War. And
Infinity War,
and you already in those movies they build the bond already.
Mm.
And then that moment where they all come through the portal, and he's like, "Oh my God, Mr. Stark!" And he just goes back to being the Spider-Man that we know. And he's like, "And then I woke up, and Doctor Strange said, oh, 5 years have gone by. They need our help. Blah blah blah."
If you just see the expression on Tony's face as he's having that conversation, it's really beautiful.
Yeah, and just to have that moment where he just hugs him, and he's like, oh, this is nice.
Yeah.
You know, I think that they really came full circle with that relationship, and I think that, you know, you're right. To see him, how he deals with the grief, it was just done so masterfully. I think that they hit the right notes with, you know, the picture, with the moment, the hug, that when he comes back, you know, it goes off of Homecoming, where he thought he was hugging him, and he's like, dude, I'm just opening the door. But, like, you know, where they are now, and I really love that. And, you know, to talk about the death scene, I'm going to be honest. I was one of those guys that I didn't know who was going to die. I didn't know what was going to happen. I was not I went in, like, with a blank mind as far as, like, what Endgame could be. I watched, like, the first three trailers or the three major trailers.
Yeah.
I did not see any TV spots. I did not see any social media after that. I came in super clean as far as, like, my ideas of how it was going to end. And I had no idea. It could have been Cap. It could have been Iron Man. I didn't know. But to finally see him snap his fingers and say, I am... And the way he delivered those lines, too, it wasn't like, I'm Iron Man. You know, boom. It was like, Iron Man. Yeah. Boom. And then he does it. And to see that, it was so fulfilling as a fan and so fulfilling as, like, you know, a moviegoer to just feel the emotion behind those words. But then also to see the aftermath and, like... And also, when he dusted them and seeing them all get dusted, and then you see Ebony Maw coming in, like, asking for help, and then, like, you know, they did that so beautifully, because I thought, okay, if they're going to dust all of them, we've already seen that. It's something we've seen it before.
Yeah.
How can they make it different this time? Because now it's the bad guys. It's not people we care about. And to just see, like, the way that they had Thanos just kind of look at everything, react, and, like, sit down, and then just, like, process it and say... Like, I mean, I felt like mentally he was saying, shit.
Yeah.
And then, to see him dusted, like, it was the complete opposite of Infinity War, because we were so sad watching people get dusted in that one, and in this one we're like, yeah, oh yeah, how do you like that dust, Thanos, you know? So, I just thought that entire scene was done so well, and it exceeded my expectations. I mean, I didn't have any, right? I didn't know what was going to happen, but it was way better than what I could have imagined it could be.
Yeah.
Any thoughts on that scene in particular?
I had no idea how they were... I didn't know if Thanos was going to be dead by the end of the movie. I didn't know if he was going to be, you know, imprisoned in some other realm or something.
Mm-hmm.
I really didn't know how they were going to go about that. And, like, we're actually, you know, seeing a different Thanos in this movie. The Thanos that we're, you know, used to from Infinity War dies right away. So right away, I was like, all right, so he's dead, so, you know, how...
What did you think of that twist? Let me ask you real quick. What did you think of that twist? Because that was something that a lot of people didn't see coming.
I didn't see it coming. Yeah, like the whole gauntlet being destroyed thing, I did kind of consider that. Thought, like, you know, because I think it was a TV spot, they did show, like, that the Avengers were going to go right after Thanos right away. And so I was like, all right, you know, so it's not going to work out somehow. Something's going to prevent them
from... They're going to fight and they're going to lose or something, yeah.
So I thought of different ways that they would lose that initial meeting.
Yeah.
So, like, the stones not being there, I had considered being a thing.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't see them killing Thanos right away. I didn't think that was coming. You know, I was completely thrown off by, like, okay, our Thanos just died. And then, you know, we get another Thanos later on.
Yep.
But I thought it was really cool that they ended up doing it with, you know, getting rid of him with another snap. I thought it was pretty poetic.
Yeah. Exactly. I felt like it was written beautifully, because it's like, we are going to do to you what you did to us.
Yeah.
And that's just like, damn, you know? And to go back to that initial scene where they kill him, I was thrown aback. I did not see that coming at all. And I thought, okay, so what happens now? At that point is when I knew this is not going to be what I thought it was going to be at all.
Yeah.
Or this is not going to be what all those theories that people were saying was.
Yeah.
And let's get into a few more things, because there's so much to cover, but some of the main things that I really think we got to talk about is Captain Marvel, number one. Mm-hmm. So she's the piece to the equation that we didn't have before, right? In Infinity War, we didn't have Captain Marvel, so we didn't know how she was going to play into this, mm-hmm. you know? And I personally thought that the way, and I know, I think we have differing thoughts, but I think mm-hmm. the way that they handled her was done very well. Mm-hmm. I know that a lot of people felt that she was underutilized, but I think that they gave her to us in the beginning and gave us that cocky attitude that we kind of had, like, from the first movie, from Captain Marvel, where she's like, all right, I'm going to go kill Thanos. And I love that. I love her spunk. I love, like, her vibe and her personality. And I think that it was exactly what the movie needed in the beginning and exactly what the Avengers needed at that time, especially with Thor kind of being this brooding guy of, like, ugh, like, I failed, I suck, I'm just going to sit here and pout. And then getting that, like, ignition that Captain Marvel, she's like, let's go, I'm gonna go kill him, I'll be right back. And it's like, what? And then he stands up to her and is like, okay, I like this girl, let's go kick his ass, you know? And for them to go do that, I really liked how they brought her there then, but then also explaining, you know, when Rhodey asks her, like, well, you know, we're all about that superhero life, but, like, where have you been this whole time? And she's like, there are other universes out there. Like, it kind of shows us the scope of you know, what she's doing, but also where she's been, because she's been gone for all these years. Yeah. What the heck happened, you know? And so I really enjoyed that they explained that, but then also, you know, gave us a little bit taste of what she's like, and then they have that. But I really like that they kind of took her away for a while, because it would have been too easy for her to just be a part of it and just, like, I mean, she's too powerful.
Yeah.
So they had to take her away without, I personally think, without, like, making her weaker than what she's supposed to be. So the reason that they gave for her being gone, hey, I'm going to be gone for a few months because I have all these other planets I got to deal with, I get it. Cool. Go do what you got to do. We'll call you if we need you, kind of a thing, right?
Yeah.
I like that they took her away and allowed us to stay with our main Avengers. And that way she didn't overshadow them. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And then she came when she needed to. During that final battle, you know, just when everything is like, oh, damn, he's raining fire on everyone, shit. I honestly think that they took her away to give us time with the original heroes because some of them were going to be gone, you know, after this movie. But then also to give her a badass entrance back into, you know, the battle. Mm. And so I really enjoyed how they did that personally. I know that you thought, I if I recall, you kind of mentioned that, like, you felt like that they weakened her. I don't think that they did. I think that they, you know, him grabbing the Power Stone and being able to, that to me makes sense. And then, but then after that, her just being able to, like, take him down and be like, dude, like, you're gonna headbutt me, but that's not gonna do shit, you know? Like, so I really enjoyed how they utilized her, and I think that they took her out and put her in at the right times. I know not everyone agrees with that, and I think that's kind of an unpopular opinion, but I don't know, I really liked it because I felt like she could have overshadowed everyone, and I didn't want that because at the end of the day, it's kind of the ending of these heroes, and I wanted to spend more time with them. Mm-hmm. So, what do you think about that?
Yeah, there's definitely things I disagree with you about. So, one thing, you didn't really touch on this, but, like, from a storytelling perspective, one of the things that, you know, they really rely on you having seen the other movies is her being a part of the team. Because her meeting everybody, you know, happens in the after credit scenes for her movie.
That's true.
So I was really thrown off by that. Like, I was like, oh, okay.
They're assuming everyone has seen that. Yeah,
you know, So you have to have seen that to get it. And
that's true.
I saw Endgame one of the times that I've seen it with people who have not seen Captain Marvel.
Really? And
so,
ooh, okay.
And so they were like, we missed something? Like, they were like, did we show up late? And I was like, no, I'll play the scene for you after she meets them in her movie. So, I don't necessarily think, like, it's not necessarily a complaint of mine, but at the same time, like, I think for the sake of cleaner writing, it would have been nicer if their introduction was during the course of the movie.
Yeah. I forgot about that. You're right.
So that's one thing that I think could have been handled differently. At the end of the day, it's not really going to change my opinion of the movie. I do think, you know, she was underutilized, but I don't think they weakened her. But what I think, they knew they had an issue with having her on the team of, she is really powerful. You know, and this happens in movies all the time. When you have a character that's too powerful, you got to find ways to keep them out of the fight or, you know, whatever, distract them from, you know, the main thing.
Yeah.
There's tons of movies that you can see this in. Like the Transformers movies, if you pay attention, Optimus is always missing from the final battle until, like, the last minute.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah. So I had wondered, like, how are they going to handle her? Because she, you know, because by the end of her movie, we see that, like, you know, one of my complaints with her movie was that, like, her villains were too weak. Because she didn't have a fair fight. So with this, I was like, man, she's really strong. Like, how are they going to handle her being in this? So, you know, they did find a good way of keeping her away from the main narrative, which, you know, was that she is going around the universe, handling other threats. I do wish she was in it a little bit more. But, I mean, realistically, I see, okay, for the most part, there's not really a need for her to travel back in time. She's going to have no idea, you know.
Yeah, that's true.
Except, I mean, they could have had her go back for the Tesseract within the course of her own movie, but that would have been kind of stupid for it to happen, like, you know.
Yeah, you would have been meddling with stuff. Yeah.
So I do see, like, why she's not present in that portion of the movie, but I don't know. I think that she could have been in it a little more. Her entrance at the end, I do really like. I will say it's a bit repetitive of her own movie, where she just comes in and destroys the ship. You know, I know this, technically Endgame, you know, was filmed before Captain Marvel.
Yes.
So that was thought of first.
Yep.
But she does the same things twice, in two movies in a row. She defeats the enemy doing the same thing. And I do really like her fight with Thanos.
And that's what I think, what I really enjoyed, because I don't think we got that in Captain Marvel.
Yeah, I agree.
We didn't get her going hand to hand with someone while being in her full form. Everyone she's kind of toying around with and just like, you know.
Yeah.
And so I really enjoy that, but I do agree with your point about the big about the entrance. I totally forgot about that. It wasn't an end credit scene. It wasn't even in the main movie. It was in the end credit scene.
Yeah.
So that narrows down the amount of people that knew about that.
Mm.
And I do agree. I expected that end credit scene to be part of the movie, and they cut it out. I wonder if it was because of time constraints.
It would make sense. If it was,
but it's kind of essential. I mean, I'm someone that has seen the movies, but what about people that haven't?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And maybe the people that saw the movie but didn't see the end credit sequence, you know? So you got a good point with that. I did not think about that. Let me ask you about a huge part of the movie that we haven't really talked about yet, and I think is one that we definitely are going to have a few different opinions on, the time travel aspect. So there's time travel in this movie. I think we all kind of saw it coming, Quantum Realm, all that stuff. I enjoyed the time travel. It was actually done a lot better than I thought it was going to be, like how they were going to explain it, or not how they were going to explain it, but how they were going to go about it. And for the fact that Tony Stark was the one that kind of was the brains that they needed to do it, I thought was really interesting. So I did enjoy the time travel aspect, and I enjoyed how they kind of went back to the previous scenes. And we're talking about, you know, the end of the Avengers. We're talking about, you know, going back in time to, you know, Tony Stark meeting his dad and seeing, you know, Peggy Carter again. I enjoyed all that. The one thing that I have an issue with is, and it might sound like a little bit of backtrack with what I just said, but some of the explanations that they did.
Okay.
So, like, I liked that they did it, and I liked where they went and how it played into the story, but the explanation of it and kind of towards the end of what happens, to me, still kind of doesn't make sense. I feel like I need, like, a scientist to, like, come and explain to me what's going on, because they do the time travel thing, and they do bring up the fact, kind of right off the bat, Hulk, Nebula, and, you know, Ant-Man and Hawkeye have this conversation about what time travel is like and how it's been portrayed in movies. And but then Hulk says this is how time travel really is. And I think that's where the explanation is, but I still don't understand it.
Yeah.
So to me, I think that they could have done a better job of explaining it, because according to how timelines usually work and how time travel usually works, and I don't mind saying it, in film, if you go and alter something in the past, then in the it'll affect that particular timeline in the future once you go back to it. So by that terminology, by that science, when Nebula kills other Nebula, the Nebula that's alive should disappear or should be gone or should no longer exist. Now, if you're telling me, well, that's one timeline and then this is the new timeline, then are we talking alternate realities then? Are we talking...
Yeah.
Well, that's Nebula...
basically what it is.
Is that Nebula then dead in their world? But then we also talk about Captain America and how he goes back in time, but never even comes back and just grows old. Like there's a lot of things with that. So,
look... contradictions.
There are a few things that I think need to be explained, and that's all I'm saying. All I'm saying is that they needed to be explained, and I think they could have done a better job of it. I like the time travel aspect. I think the first half of the movie where they're doing that, a little bit slow, but I'm okay with that because I don't need this whole movie to be bang, 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 everything left and right.
It wouldn't fit any worse.
Right, exactly. Yeah. So, like, it took some time to build up to it. We get there, fine. And then you get that battle scene, and then everything from there is craziness, right? And I don't mind that. So, but to me, it was just the explanation behind it and some of the things that didn't end up making sense to me towards the end of the movie. But I just kind of, I didn't brush it off, but I thought, you know what? I'm okay. I mean,
Time travel,
right, yeah. Right. So, but then that leaves us with more questions at the end. Mm-hmm. So to me, my only issue with that is that the explanation, I think they were trying to explain it, but in the end, they actually ended up confusing me a little more with that conversation that they had. What did you think about that?
I thought the time travel was explained pretty well. I mean, so they, you know, they make it clear, like, they crap on all other time travel movies.
Which was
like,
funny. I liked that bit. I liked it.
They're like, don't pay attention to that. My thing is, there is contradictions, and there's people that argue, like, no, there's no contradictions. But then I read an interview with the Russo brothers, and then I read an interview with the screenwriters. Mm-hmm. And actually, they gave separate answers about something, which shows that there is contradictions in there.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
They were speaking about, and I know you want to talk about this, so this will kind of segue into that.
Yeah.
They were speaking about Captain America's fate.
Okay.
And the Russo brothers say, when Cap went back, and I choose to believe the Russo brothers' logic because it follows the logic explained in the movie.
Yes.
They said when he jumped back, he went to an alternate reality, and him living with Peggy is an alternate reality.
Okay.
So they said that by the end of the movie, he had to have jumped back. Now, because of that, okay, I agree with that. That's kind of the logic the movie gives you. My complaint is, how did he jump back? Because, you know, the Hulk was monitoring the thing, and
you know, he pressed it. He doesn't pop back there. Yeah. He pops back.
Yeah.
He doesn't even pop. He just shows up. Or he knew where to be at what time.
Mm.
So, continue. But keep going.
And then, so, you know, when we see Cap next, he's sitting over at that bench. So then that, you know, feeds into the theory of, well, that's why he just went back in time in this reality and lived in this reality.
And lived it.
And that's what the screenwriters say. The screenwriters say they wrote it as he was, it's a loop. He was always supposed to live in this reality and grow old. So,
but then to me it's like, okay, so you're telling me this entire time there's been two Captain Americas and one has just been living with Peggy and the other one's been out and about doing like superhero things?
Yeah.
So
following the rules they set in the movie, Cap lived his life in a different reality.
So, okay, so if that's the case, then my point is, why not even mention the word alternate reality? Why not mention the word dimensions or other, you know, other linear...
I think they say dimensions, don't they? I thought the ancient one says, like... You know, she doesn't say dimensions. She says my reality. So it's worded like that, but...
Yeah, so... And that's a good point to bring up. The Ancient One kind of does a better job of trying to explain it.
Yeah.
But then Mark Ruffalo, the Hulk, just kind of like...
Mark Ruffalo,
guys,
breaks
hey!
Character, and he's...
breaks character, and yeah. No, but then the Hulk is the one who kind of says, like... Like, everything she explains, he reverts by saying, like, well, if we just bring it back, and then, you know? And then it's like, the Ancient One's like, well, shit, you're smarter than me, you know? And I really like seeing her, by the way.
Was really cool.
It's one of those cameos that you're like, yes, you know?
It's cool to know that, like, I like that this one, we didn't really touch on this before, it, like, shows you different angles of scenes from...
Exactly, like what was going on during the Battle of New York at the you know, Doctor Strange house, you know? Not the house, but... And I love what she says, like, oh, you're 5 years too early.
Yeah.
Like, you know, he's performing medical surgery over there, and it's like, oh, dang.
That's
like,
cool to know that she always knew.
Yeah, and that's the awesome part. So, yeah, it actually gives more credibility to the Ancient One, and I respect her more now, like, in that movie. You know, I did not know about the directors and the writers saying that, but there's still contradiction then.
Yeah.
So I have some issues with that, and I think that needs to be cleared up, whether that's going to happen in a bonus feature, like on a Blu-ray or something, or in the next film, or in the next, later down the road.
Yeah.
I don't know, because I think that they also low-key kind of set up some stuff without us knowing that it was set up.
Like, low-key. taking the Tesseract.
Yeah, that's another alternate reality then. Like, what happened with that one then? So does that mean that in that world, Loki does end up finishing the job with Thanos, or maybe not? We don't know. Yeah. And so it opens up a lot of possibilities, but then it also brings up a lot of questions, right? Mm. And another thing that we're going to move on to real quick is that also added a lot of questions for me. I mentioned it a little bit. Is Nebula. Mm. Nebula plays a pretty big role in this movie, just how she did in the comics, but completely different, right?
Yeah.
For different reasons. What are your thoughts on the idea of Nebula having, you know, the two Nebulas and one of them being able to see, you know, for them to see each other's memories? And and the way that it's explained is that Ebony Maw says there are two Nebulas, but they're sharing the same network.
Yeah.
What did you think about that? And then I'll give you my thoughts.
So the first time I saw it, because I think, if I remember correctly, right before, like, the Nebula scenes, we see Loki make off with the Tesseract.
Mm-hmm.
So I was like, that's it. That he's gonna go and, you know, screw things up, and that's how we get, you know, like, a villain out of the movie.
Ooh, okay.
So I didn't think, like, Loki was gonna be the main villain, but I thought, you know, he's gonna go back, he's gonna report to Thanos, he's gonna say, here's the stone, and, you know, that'll set off that, you know, motion of events. Mm-hmm. And then that's not what happened at all. We, you know, it was Nebula that ended up screwing up the plan without realizing that she was going to. Yeah, that caught me off guard. And I think, you know, it's going to catch anybody off guard. The way it's handled, like, we're seeing what she was doing at that time, and then boom, out of nowhere, she's, projecting modern-day Nebula's, you know, like, memories or whatever.
And they kind of don't explain why either. It just kind of happens, you know?
Yeah. I don't know. I do like it. Because, you know, if you think about it, you know, when, for example, like, they use the word, I think, network on purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Because realistically, I mean, what does our modern day world look like? Everything's on, you know, online. Different networks, you know, wireless connections. So it does make sense that, like, these futuristic beings would have some sort of...
Yeah, I mean, I'm not saying it doesn't make sense. Unlike the timeline thing, to me, my issue is not it making sense. To me, my issue was, like, I think it was kind of a, I wish, you know, and you know, okay, so Nebula having that brings the 2014 Thanos into the 2018, 2019, you know, Avengers, right?
Yeah.
And once that happens, once he shows up and, you know, blows up the base or whatever, I'm down. I'm cool with it. I know what's going on. I'm okay with it. But Nebula being the reason for it and kind of just, like, what goes on, I felt like it was kind of convenient. It was kind of like, oh, so that tends to happen? Okay, cool. But so then does that mean since they're two roadies, like, are they going to be on the same system, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. I just felt like I understand it. I was just like, maybe I could have used, like, another reason for it.
Yeah.
And the initial time that I watched it, it did confuse me at first. But once it got explained, then I was like, okay. Honestly, I think it was just, like, it was a way for the writers to have a reason for Thanos to know what's going on and to catch on and to...
Yeah.
It was used to move the plot along, I feel. Mm. And I just think that they could have found maybe a better reason. I don't hate it completely, but I did... Like, I do remember in the theater being like, okay, we'll go with it, you know?
I would have preferred Loki being the reason. Like,
I mean, and why not? I mean, Loki is a beloved character, right? Mm. But I think that they also did it because they wanted to pay homage to Nebula's from the comic books and stuff like that, giving her a bigger role. In the end, you know, it was explained, and I did like where it took us. I just felt that the way it took us could have maybe been done a little better. And yeah, now that you bring up Loki, I kind of wish I would have seen that, you know? Because, yeah, where the heck is he? We don't know. the little heart attack he Ant-Man gives Tony Stark, and he's like, we're gonna try this, I don't even know what's gonna happen. He's like, oh my god, that is awesome, you know? And so, okay, so moving on to another thing, and this is all, like, time travel related, and anytime you do time travel in a movie,
There's gonna be complications,
there's gonna be questions. I actually think that as far as time travel goes, this movie did a pretty good job, but it might have left us with a little bit more questions than I would have liked, but... Captain America, we touched on it a little bit already. You gave me the explanation from the Russo brothers, and that actually kind of makes a little bit more sense. But once again, if I didn't happen to watch that interview, I wouldn't have known. Yeah. I think it could have been done a little bit better.
I agree with that. It should be more clear in film.
It should be more clear in film. And the fact that he didn't show up at that spot makes me believe the writer's theory more, because it's like, he's just been living here, and he said, yep, this is the year at this time. They're going to be here. I'm going to go sit on that bench.
Yeah.
And so, but I think that there's also explaining to do as far as, like, okay, so then how, when he brought that shield back from the other one, if it is an alternate reality, then does that Captain America over there not have a shield? He stole it from him? Or there's a lot of complications with that scene, I think, but, and even the directors and the writers can't really get it right. The other issue that I kind of have with that scene, and one thing that I saw, real quick, one thing that I saw that I think I read somewhere was that you could tell, and after watching it a few times, you could tell Bucky knows. Yeah. Bucky knew what was going on, which means that maybe in the past, Captain America told him, or showed himself up to him and might have let him know, but, because some people are theorizing that Bucky already knew that was going to happen, because he's already had contact with Captain America before that point.
See, that just makes things messy, though.
It does make things messy, but if you watch it again, look at his facial expression. Not once does he budge or have any reaction, just like Falcon is reacting. Yeah. You know, he's like, you know, and if you watch, when Bucky hugs Captain America, he's like, I'm going to miss you. He's talking to him as if he's not going to see him for a long time.
Yeah.
As to where, you know, Falcon is just like, all right, man, yeah, go do you. You sure you don't want me to come with you, man? You know, it's a mission. He's just treating it as a mission. Bucky's treating it as a goodbye. You know, and so that to me was like, okay. That was just something aside that I wanted to mention. But one thing that I do kind of, it's not an issue, but I just kind of had a preference of something else was the fact that Falcon is going to be the next Captain America. When he gives the shield to Falcon, I don't mind Anthony Mackie. I think, you know, and this is going to sound like the dumbest reason ever, but I just think, technically speaking, Bucky is better suited for the shield. And that's all I'm basing this off of, technicality. The actors, characters, I think either one of them could do it. Obviously, it's been done in the comics both ways. But technically speaking, Bucky has some sort of super soldier serum in him that makes him stronger, bigger, whatever it might be. He also has a freaking metal arm. And he also doesn't... So he has, like, strength, ability, agility, you know, like... similar to Captain America, that's why they can go one-on-one. He has technical training, he knows how to fight in multiple different styles. Also, he doesn't have the wings that Falcon has to deal with. Like, I think it's going to be awkward, and I know it's been done in the comics, but as far as a movie, like, reasons, having the shield and the wings, is he going to ditch the wings and just have the shield, or is he going to try to do both? Like, to me, that's just going to be a little awkward and weird. I just felt like the shield was better suited... and the mantle was better suited for Bucky, just based off of technicality, than it is for Falcon. Did you have any issues with it at all, or were you actually really happy that Falcon took the mantle?
I don't really feel for it either way. Okay. I think, you know, I mean, comic-wise, Bucky gets it first. So I honestly did not care which way it went.
Okay.
But I agree with what you're saying. Like, Bucky is literally, like, physically better suited for it. But as a character, I don't think he's worthy of the shield yet. I mean, just because
realistically... And I've heard people say that, so yeah.
Just because realistically, he, you know, died, came back as a Hydra assassin.
Mm-hmm. Killed many people.
Yeah, killed many people. And I'm not saying that he can't redeem himself from that, but what I'm saying is, like, literally his character arc is he's killed all these people, he was this Hydra assassin, he realizes that, you know, he's been brainwashed. He's been on the, you know, then he's on the run for 2 years, or, yeah, I think it's 2 years.
Yeah.
And then, immediately, he goes under in Wakanda, you know, to be fixed, comes back, pretty much almost immediately has to deal with Infinity War.
Yeah.
Dies, and then he just came back. So, realistically, I don't think he's fully there to take up the mantle. Whereas, Falcon, you know, well, Bucky has this too, but, you know, Falcon served his country. When he came back, he was helping veterans. When the time came and, you know, he had to stand up against a branch of government that was corrupt, he did what he had to do. Yeah. He's been fighting alongside the Avengers ever since. I think from a character standpoint,
it you're makes right. sense. Morally speaking, Falcon is better suited for the mantle.
Yeah.
Physically speaking, Bucky's better suited for the shield.
Yeah.
And you're right. Those are all valid points, and I think I might just be nitpicky about it. The thing about Captain America, you know, is like he's 10 times stronger or faster than your average man, right?
Yeah.
Falcon's a human being.
Yeah.
He gets shot.
He's gonna need to start taking some injections.
You know, I mean, I don't know. I'm just thinking of it too literally, I guess. But you're right. Morally speaking, yes, he deserves a mantle. And also, he's been fighting next to Captain America this entire time as to where Bucky's been fighting against him, you know? So there is that dilemma. So you're right. I
think down the line, Bucky can take up the mantle.
But I also don't want it to become like a James Bond thing, where it's like, all right, you're Captain America now. Now you're Captain America now. I mean, at the end of the day, I think I just have that opinion just because I wanted Captain America to stay Captain America. I think Chris Evans is the best Captain America there ever will be, but I mean, that's just, you know, me still not allowing myself to reminisce with the idea that he's not going to be Captain America.
I agree with you. Like,
it's hard to let go.
When the movie was ending, I was like, oh, cool, we still have Cap. Like, he made it
out. Yeah, I was like,
And then they're like, no, screw you. Like, he's done. So, I agree with you. I much rather Steve Rogers still be Captain America.
Yes.
And like I said, that's why, at this point, I really don't care either way who takes the mantle.
I'm actually surprised you said that you don't care. Yeah. Because I thought, to me, that was a big thing. That was a big moment. And I did feel like
I like the scene. I
like
the moment.
I like the scene. And I thought they kind of shoehorned it a little bit at the end where I was like, wait, this is a big moment. Are you just going to do it here right now? Like, I mean, okay, I guess you have to though, right?
Yeah.
But going kind of back to some of the questions that we still have, where do you see the MCU with how amazing we just said that it is? Where do you see it going?
I'm going to be quite honest. If they were today, be like, that's the end. I think I would accept it. I would be like, you know what?
I'll take what I have.
I would be like, you know what? Okay, I feel satisfied. You deserve it.
Yeah.
Obviously, I don't want that to happen. But like, I would, you know, like I would be like, okay, that's a beautiful ending. You know, I accept that. At this point, so much is up in the air. You know, I can't wait for Spider-Man Far From Home. Spider-Man's my favorite character ever since I was a little kid. He's been my favorite character, and I love that he's gonna be the first character to lead us through like. You just went through that whole saga. Now here's what's next. I'm excited to see whether this whole multiverse thing is true and is going to play a role in the future.
Yeah, there's a lot of things. Yeah,
we have the Disney Plus shows coming.
Yes, and that's another thing. I'm glad you brought that up. I'll let you finish up here, but that is another thing that is being thrown into this that we got to talk about for sure. So go ahead.
Yeah, because you know, I mean, there's been stuff like Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. before, which. Oh, we didn't mention this. This is the first movie that has a character from the shows.
Jarvis, but not from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., though.
No, he's from Agent Carter.
From Agent Carter, Which I thought was interesting that they...
I really liked that.
But I was surprised that out of all the shows that they would have picked... I mean, obviously, I wanted to see the Netflix guys, but you know, that was never going to happen. That's like the first time we've had any sort of crossover. But for me, I mean, I'm excited to see... I completely agree with you. If it ended today, I would say... Thank you for everything, you know, like, this is exactly what I've needed. Boom, it's over. I actually, personally, I feel like I have so many questions with the timeline, with you know, what's going to happen with some of these characters and where do they go from now. I mean, Black Panther, you know, Doctor Strange, Captain Marvel. I mean, how do these characters, how are they affected after all this has happened? Spider-Man, we see a little bit, him going back to school with Ned. I love that moment. That's one of the moments I teared up at. How do they move on from this? How is the world affected? Because that's another thing we did not mention, man. And I have to mention this right now. The fact that they snap them back into the time that they are.
Yeah.
And they say, do not change anything that has happened in the last 5 years. Just bring everyone back. How does that affect it? How are age differences going to matter?
Yeah. Because I think pretty much everybody thought like, oh, they're just going to undo.
And go back and live their life from that point forward.
Which... You know, if they had done that, it would take away a certain... It would take something away from Infinity War. Infinity War wouldn't hold the same weight anymore.
Yeah.
So I do really like that they did that.
I like it, but I also feel that it either... It's not going to bring problems, but it's going to bring... Like, I feel like future filmmakers are going to have to, like, play into that.
Yeah.
And be like, I'm going to be handcuffed.
There's no way you can ignore that.
Yeah, exactly. But also, I mean, you know, I was talking to someone and saying, how is that going to affect Homecoming? I mean, what if Ned didn't get snapped and he's 5 years older? He's out of high school.
Yeah.
You know, and then Peter Parker's back and he's still a high schooler. Mm. Or what if MJ?
Yeah.
You know, like, who got snapped, who didn't, how does that affect? Because, and the reason that, you know, some people might say like, oh, well, we don't know that for sure. Hello, Cassie is 5 years older now.
Yeah.
And Scott, you know, is like, oh my God, you're so big.
Yeah.
So.
And Tony has a daughter.
Tony has a daughter. So it's like. How is that going to affect the future? And that's probably the biggest question that I have, is how is that time jump and bringing everyone back how is the world going to react to, oh my God, everyone was gone for 5 years and now they're back. What do we do now? How do we handle this? How are relationships repaired and how are relationships broken? And are any, is that going to affect any of our heroes? Is Doctor Strange going to come back?
Somebody else be at the Sanctum or something?
Yeah, and some, I saw someone mention that. That's, I personally think now that's the plot line for Black Panther 2.
Yeah.
Who has been in charge of Wakanda since Black Panther's been gone? M'Baku.
It did show him, like, with his family and...
Right.
Yeah.
Right, but I mean, like...
But no, I totally hear what you're saying.
Right, and so it's, like, interesting, but I'm also, like... Like, I'm interested, but I'm also like, I'm speculative. Like, yeah. I don't know what's going to happen. So, all right, guys. So, as we're wrapping up here, this movie, a lot goes on with it. We probably miss some stuff. I mean, it's going to happen.
We could talk about this movie.
We could talk about it for hours. Yeah. But we do have to wrap up. So, at the end of the day, this movie, actually, for me, leaves us with more questions than I thought we would. I mean, it is an end. It is a finale. But it also kind of lets me wonder what's next and what in the world could Marvel pull up their sleeve now. As we're giving our final thoughts, obviously I thought that, you know, this movie was fantastic. I thought that as a fan, it was everything I wanted to be. As a critic, I maybe thought there were some things that could have been done a little better. Mm-hmm. But overall, I enjoyed this film so much. I thought that, is it going to be my number one movie of all time in the MCU? Maybe not. I think I do still put Infinity War over it, and maybe the original Avengers over it, because the original Avengers, to me, will always have a special place for what it meant to me at the time, and, you know, never having seen something like that. But at the end of the day, guys, this movie is something that I could have only dreamed of, and, you know, if it weren't for a few things that maybe I thought could have been done better, it's up there in my top three for sure.
Yeah.
And it might literally be Avengers, Infinity War, Endgame. Sorry, Age of Ultron, but yeah. Anyways, unless we talk about that. I like it too. I like it too. I just thought there was some stuff. Anyways, I don't want to get into that.
Yeah.
But we got to talk about the money this movie is making.
Oh my God.
As of right now, guys, it's only been out for 2 weekends.
Yeah, not even a full 2 weeks.
It's only been out for 2 weekends, and it's already the number 2 movie of all time. I hope in the future, this will be the number 1 movie of all time. It's been making crazy money.
Yeah.
I think that this is a historic film. I think it's worthy of everyone going to go see this. I definitely recommend it to even people that don't watch the MCU. I mean, you might have some questions on it.
I would say watch the other movies first. But
yeah. I think it's an event film. It's an event film. It's something that everyone's going to be talking about at work, at your school, or wherever, whatever you're doing. Mm. And it's something that everyone should have an opinion on.
Yeah.
So those are my final thoughts on it. What's your final take on Endgame?
No, I agree with you. I do think that this is like...
It's like the season finale.
I can't describe it. Like, there's never been a movie like this. Yeah. And who knows when there will be another movie like this again. So yeah, I do think everybody should see it. You know, I've had, you know, friends and stuff text me and be like, oh my God, I'm sitting, you know, in class and, you know, they're talking about Endgame over there.
Yep.
You know, I'm wherever and I hear people talking about it. This is something that it's a huge cultural moment. Like you said, a movie has never made this much money this fast.
And it crashed websites. I could not get my tickets when it came out because AMC was crashed. And I
had to go in person.
People had to go in person. We're like, what the heck?
We live in a crazy time. I am incredibly, you know, thankful for the fact that I have lived to see Endgame.
Same.
It's
a once-in-a-lifetime thing that, you know, for us as fans, but also just in general, like, the amount of money this movie's making, and you're right, it's a cultural movement, it's a cultural event that is going to go down in history as, like, you know, Endgame Fever, or, you know, the Avengers era, you know, or something. I mean, this is historic for film. I mean, there's never been a cinematic universe, there's never been a 22-movie arc. And for it to do that and to be as successful as it is and to be as good as it is, I think speaks volumes to Kevin Feige, speaks volumes to Marvel Studios, to Disney, to everyone that's been involved. I mean, you know, all the directors and all the actors that have worked on it, from the beginning, Iron Man, you know, and to come 22 films, and it's absolutely amazing. That's going to do it, guys, for myself, for Edgar here. You've gotten the real breakdown for Avengers Endgame. We hope you enjoyed it, and we will see you guys in the next video.
We love you, 3000.